Chapter 38, The Second War Begins. Chapter 38'i göstermeyi unutmuştum. Son bölüm. Beşinci kitabı da bitiriyoruz. İki kitabımız kalıyor. Benim de bir ayım kalıyor okul başlayana kadar video çekmek için. Altıncı kitap, yani çok büyük ihtimal bitecek bir aksilik çıkmazsa. Yedinci kitap bitecek gibi durmuyor. Bu durumda okul başladığı zaman ben yurtta kaldığım için, yani video çekebileceğim bir yer ayarlayamayacağım için falan, orada birkaç aylık bir ara vermem gerekebilir. Hani onun dışında yine ara tatille falan devam ederiz of course. Durum bu. Bir saniye. Başlayalım den. The Second War Begins dediği. Buradaki bu Second War ne Abdullah diyorsunuz. Şey diyoruz, Frenz'in konuştuğu Mars parlıyor dediği diye, hani böyle. İşte bir tane büyük bir büyücüler arasındaki büyük bir savaş başlamadan önce de parladıydı falan. Bir kere daha parlıyor. İşte o büyücülerin arasındaki büyük savaşın benzeri bir savaşın olacağını anlıyoruz. Cacür falan diyordu. Buradaki The Second War dediği o Frenz'in lafındaki Second War'la aynı. Kane, devam da. He who must not be named returns. Böyle devasa bir gazete sayfası düşünün. Direkt. He who must not be named returns. Bütün sayfada. O derece büyük olay. In a brief statement Friday night. Ha, şu an gazete haberi okuyoruz. İtalya yazılması lazım. İşte Defos Mefos'u var, biliyorsunuz okuduğumuz kitabın, ama no problemo, bunlar önemli şeyler değil. In a brief statement Friday night, Minister of Magic Cornelius Fudge confirmed that he who must not be named has returned to this country and is active once more. It is with great regret that I must confirm that the wizard styling himself Lord, well, you know who I mean, is alive and among us again, said Fudge, looking tired and flustered as he addressed reporters. It is with almost equal regret that we report the mass revolt of the Dementors of Azkaban, who have shown themselves averse to continuing in the Ministry's employ. We believe that the Dementors are currently taking direction from Lord Tingi. Tingi dediğin ne lan burada? Merak ettim. Voldemort diyemedi. Ama bir şey demesi gerekti. Tingi. A person or thing whose name one has forgotten, does not know or does not wish to mention. Tingi.
Thingy. Thingy.
Tingi.
Thingy.
Tingi diye okuyor. Yani Tingi demiyor ama Tingi diye okunuyor Lord. Tingi. İşte Lord şey falan yaptı yani. We urge the magical population to remain vigilant. The Ministry is currently publishing guides to elementary home and personal defense that will be delivered free to all wizarding homes within the coming month. The minister's statement was met with dismay and alarm from the wizarding community, which as recently as last Wednesday was receiving ministry assurances that there was no truth whatsoever in these persistent rumors that you know who is operating amongst us once more. The minister's statement was met with dismay and şu an kitap başlığı da bir Harry'nin düşünceleri gibi mi okuyoruz yoksa gazete devam ediyor, onu anlayamadım. The minister's statement was met with dismay and alarm from the wizarding community, which as recently as last Wednesday was receiving ministry assurances that there was no truth whatsoever in these persistent rumors that you know who is operating amongst us once more. Harry'nin düşünceleri bence bu. Aynen. The tales of the events that led to the ministry turn around are still hazy, though it is believed that he who must not be named and a select band of followers known as Death Eaters gained entry to the Ministry of Magic itself on Thursday evening. Burası gazete oldu yine. O zaman burasının da gazete olması lazım. Kafam karıştı böyle. Yarısını İtalyan, yarısını normal yazınca siz, benim de kafam karışıyor, tamam mı? The minister's statement was met with dismay and alarm from the wizarding community, which as recently as last Wednesday was receiving ministry assurances that there was no truth whatsoever in these persistent rumors that we know who is operating amongst us once more. The tales of the events that led to the ministry turnaround are still hazy, though it is believed that he who must not be named in a select band of followers, known as Death Eaters, gained entry to the Ministry of Magic itself on Thursday evening. Albus Dumbledore, newly reinstated headmaster of Hogwarts School of Witchcraft and Wizardry, reinstated member of the International Confederation of Wizards, and reinstated chief warlock of the Wizengamot, was unavailable for comment last night. He has insisted for a year that you know who was not dead, as was widely hoped and believed, but recruiting followers once more for a fresh attempt to seize power. Meanwhile, the boy who led. He has insisted for a year that you know who was not dead, as was widely hoped and believed, but recruiting followers once more for a fresh attempt to seize power. Yani böyle insanlar şey düşündüydü diyor herhalde. Onlar işte Voldemort'un hayatta olmadığını, onun işte taraftarlarının yaptığı olaylardan dolayı ortada birkaç ölüm, Jethrut olduğunu şey diyordu. O taraftarlar da ortada ölümlere sebep oluyorlar. Çünkü bir şekilde böyle Voldemort gibi, Voldemort'un sahip olduğu zamanda güce sahip olmak için gibi bir şey diyor herhalde. Meanwhile the boy who lead falan gazete devam ediyordu. O kadar böyle karışık geldi ki böyle şu an bunu okuduğum. Hani böyle bana hak veriyorsunuzdur bence. Yani şu ana kadar kaç kitap okuduk? Tam 4 tane Harry Potter okuduk. 5.sini bitirdik, sadece 5.sinden Bing'den fazla sayfa okuduk falan. Hani bunu bir türlü böyle bir şey olamadım. Hani işte o italik yazma olaylarındaki sorun. Bunlar neden italik değil falan. Yeri geldi bir paragrafı geçiyor, diğerine geçiyor. Harry mi konuşuyor, şu mu konuşuyor, bu mu konuşuyor anlayamadım falan derken sonuç olarak bir şeyler yanlış burada ama ne yanlış? Aklıma gelmiyor yani. Yine bir düşüneyim, bir şey gelecek mi aklıma? Vallahi bilemedim. Tamam. Devam de. There you are, Harry. I knew they'd drag you into it somehow, said Hermione, looking over the top of the paper at him. They were in the hospital wing. Harry was sitting on the end of Ron's bed and they were both listening to Hermione read the front page of the Sunday Prophet. Ginny, whose ankle had been mended in a trice by Madame Pomfrey, was curled up at the foot of Hermione's bed. Neville, whose nose had likewise been returned to its normal size and shape, was in a chair between the two beds, and Luna, who had dropped in to visit clutching the latest edition of the Quibbler, was reading the magazine upside down, and apparently not taking in a word Hermione was saying. He's the boy who lead again now, though, isn't he? Said Ron darkly. Not such a show-off maniac anymore, eh? He held himself to a handful of chocolate frogs from the immense pile on his bedside cabinet, 3x5 to Harry, Ginny, and Neville, and ripped off the wrapper of his own with his teeth. There were still deep wells on his forearms where the brain's tentacles had wrapped around them. According to Madame Pomfrey, toes could leave deeper scarring than almost anything else, though since she had started applying copious amounts of Dr. Ubley's oblivious unction, there seemed to be some improvement. Yes, they were very complimentary about you now, Harry, said Hermione, now scanning down the article. A long voice of truth, perceived as unbalanced, yet never wavered in the story. Wavered, şuna bir bakalım. Wavered, öyle miydi? Ne diyorlar? Perceived as unbalanced, böyle dengesiz gibi algılan insanlar tarafından ama hiçbir zaman kendi hikayesini anlatmaktan vazgeçmedi. Integrity diyorlar, integrity'si var. Doğruyu hep söylemeye devam etti. A lone voice of truth. Doğrunun yalnız sesi. Dumbledore ve bundan başka kimse şey etmedi. Bütün dünya bunlara karşı oldu falan. Bütün İngiltere falan. forced to be ridiculed and slandered. Böyle bir sürü saçma sapan tavırlara maruz kaldı. Öyle kalmaya zorlandı falan saçma sapan insanlar yüzünden falan. Harry'i böyle bayağı övmeye başladılar. Of course hoşumuza gidiyor. Altıncı kitabın en azından Dumbledore'un ölümüne kadar ki olan kısımdaki atmosfer hoş olacak bayağı. Çünkü güvende olacağız Dumbledore'ine. Zaten güçlü bir insan biliyoruz. Bir de öte yandan böyle Fudge gibi insanlar olabildiğince etrafında insan toplayıp Dumbledore'u indirmeye kalkışmayacaklar falan. Dumbledore böyle rahat rahat yapacağını yapacak. Voldemort'u araştıracak. Çerçürt öte yandan Harry böyle direkt rahat olacak. Millet ona şey demeyecek falan. Ne demeyecek. Laf atamayacak. Kafasını bozamayacak. Çocuğu gelemeyecekler falan. Bayağı iyi hissedeceğiz yani. O açıdan. Öyle. Diyecek bir şey var mıdır? Devam. Sedermoni, Frowny. I noticed they don't mention the fact that it was them doing all the ridiculing and slandering though. She winced slightly and put a hand to her ribs. The curse Dolohov had used on her, though less effective than it would have been had he been able to say the incantation aloud, had nevertheless caused, in Madame Pomfrey's words, quite enough damage to be going on with. Hermione was having to take 10 different types of potion every day, and although she was improving greatly, was already bored with the hospital wing. You know who's the last attempt to take over? Pages 2 to 4. What the ministry should have told us. Page 5. Why nobody listened to Albus Dumbledore. Pages 6 to 8. Exclusive interview with Harry Potter. Page 9. Well, said Hermione, folding up the newspaper and throwing it aside. It's certainly given them lots to write about. And that interview with Harry is an exclusive. It's the one that was in the Quibbler months ago. Did he sold it to them, said Luna vaguely, turning a page of the Quibbler. He got a very good price for it too, so we're going to go on an expedition to Sweden this summer and see if we can catch a crumpled-horned snorkel. Hermione seemed to struggle with herself for a moment, then said, that sounds lovely, yani öyle bir şey yok falan demek için diyecekti, kendini tuttu. İyi duruyor falan yaptı böyle. Ginny caught Harry's eye and looked away quickly, grinning. İkisi de böyle sessiz sessiz gülüp neye gülüyorsunuz deyip Luna'nın Hermione'nin son anda kendisini öyle bir şey yok demekten zor tuttuğunu anlamasına engel olmak için birbirine baklar hemen dönüp böyle sessiz sessiz gülmemek için kendi kendilerini gülücüklerini bitirip normal bir suratla geri dönmeye çalıştılar. Devam. So anyway, said Hermione, sitting up a little straighter and wincing again. What's going on in school? Well, Flitwick's got rid of Fred and George Swam, said Ginny. He did it in about 3 seconds, but he let a tiny patch under the window when he's robbed it off. Why, said Hermione, looking startled. Oh, he just says it was a really good bit of magic, said Ginny, shrugging. I think he left it as a monument to Fred and George, said Ron, through a mouthful of chocolate. Şu an mutlu son şeylerini hissediyoruz of course. Hani Sirius öldü falan ama öte yandan hani 5. kitap, koca kitap boyunca 5. kitabı bitirdik ya ben cidden takdir ediyorum. 1000'den fazla sayfa bunu okuması ayrı bir dert. Bunu baştan sona okuyan birinden dinlemesi de ayrı bir dert. Ve o birisinin geri geldiği uzun uzun sessizlikleri, geri geldiği uzun uzun yorumları, belki bir kısmını anlamadınız. Yanlış anlattığı için, doğru anlatamadığı için falan. Ama hala buradasınız. Kendime daha alkış, size daha alkış. Very good. Devam. I think he left it as a monument to Fred and George, said Ron through a mouthful of chocolate. They sent me all this, you know, he told Harry, pointing at the small mountain of frogs beside them. Must be doing all right out of that jog shop, eh? Hermione looked rather disapproving and asked, so has all the trouble stopped now, Dumbledore's back? Yes, said Neville, everything settled right back down again. Burada daha demin bir şey diyecektim ben, onu demeyi unuttum. Ha işte mutlu sonumsu bir şey var yine, ortalık rahat. Ama bu son, hani 7. kitaptaki o anormal derecede kötü şartlardan önceki yazarın bizi son bir defa Harry böyle mutlu olsun falan gibisinden Harry'e verdiği ödül olacak 6. kitabın 4'te 3'ü diyelim. Aynen. Hani bu açıdan çok hoş, aşırı hoş. Hani bir yandan sondan bir önceki step. Hani iki kitap kaldı oğlum, iki kitap. Yedi kitabın beşini okumuş olacağız. İki kitap kaldı. Ve beşinci kitaptan sonra hiçbir kitap çok uzun gelmediği için biraz hızlı da geçecek falan. Yolumuz sona yaklaşıyor Harry Potter konusunda. Yine bir Ozan Bidon hikayeleri, Cedric'te onları falan da okuyacağım. Yani işi başladığımız işi doğru düzgün bitirmek gibisinden ama onlar çok hızlı olacak ve önemsiz olacaklar. Sırf yazdı diye okuyorum. Yoksa sevdiğimden falan değil yani. Ozan Bidon'un 5 tane hikayesi varmış. Hermione'nin 300-400 sayfalık kitap sallıyor Hermione. 5 tane hikaye verecek bize. Bir de üstünde de Dumbledore'un notları varmış falan. Ozan Bidon'un hikayeleri okuyoruz falan olacağız. Fucking hell yani. Ama okuyacağız. Yazmış. İngilizce. Gerçek İngilizce için hiç olmadı. Ondan sonra bir Kur'an olayımız olacak. Bir aksilik çıkmazsa. Bayağı korkuyorum, çekiniyorum da milletin kötü, yanlış, hakaret edici yorumlar yapmasına falan da onu direkt onun için uyaracağım açıklamalarda. Böyle böyle direkt gerçek for the only sole purpose of gerçek İngilizce if and only if, işte şu an aklıma gelmedi o tabirler. Sadece gerçek İngilizce için yapıyorum bu işi diyeceğim. Kesinlikle başka bir amacım yok. Tefsir, fıkıh, cattur, ne anlama geldiklerini bile bilmiyorum bu kelimelerin diyeceğim. Cidden de bilmiyorum. Onun için ciddi bir şey, yorum, katma olayı olacak illa ama böyle bir şeyim yok. Taraftar toplamak falan filan gibi işte. İnsanlar böyle algılayacak çünkü. Onu böyle özellikle ifade edeceğim ama onun dışında çok apayrı bir olay olacak. Yani o kesinlikle yakından uzaktan uzun zamandır yaklaşmadım Kur'an'a. Direkt böyle orijinal tepkiler görünecek tam o esnada. Kaydedilmesini istiyorum işte. Onun için kesinlikle spoiler falan almayacağım Kur'an'dan. Yani bir kere okuduydum hatta. İki ya da üç kere okudum ama çok önceden. En son okuduğumda 3 sene önce falan diye yani herhalde. Onu da İngilizce okuduydum. Okuduğum ilk İngilizce kitaplardan biri Kur'an. Bu kanalda okuduğumuz ilk İngilizce kitaplardan biri de Kur'an olacak falan. Bunlar güzel, happy coincidences diyelim. Hayatımda ilk defa İngilizce Harry Potter okuduğum zaman geldi aklıma. Zaten gerçi bir kere okudum baştan sona. O da böyle çok çok ayrı hoş bir şeydi biliyor musunuz? Hani böyle en sevdiğim kitap uğruna geçemediğim için hazırlık geçme sınavında Kars'ta böyle pusmak zorunda kalmış. Benimle beraber okula başlayan insanlar kampüste takılıyor, Cerçurt falan. Hani bütün o nefretin, yenilmişliğin içinde en sevdiğim kitabı işte İngilizce okuyaraktan o geçemediğim sınavı geçebilecek seviyeye kendini yaklaştırmanın bilinci falan. Böyle hayatımdaki en çaresizlik içinde bulduğum en güzel fırsatlar, zamanlar gibi bir şey olabilir. Benim hazırlığı geçemediğim zamanlar gayet gergin zamanlardı. Yani günde resmen 9-10 saat İngilizce ile geçiriyordum ama yine böyle tatmin olmuyordum. Yine böyle yetmeyecek gibi geliyordu falan. Hani öyle bir panik içindeydim. Ama bir yandan bu süreci ne oldu? İşte Harry Potter okuyarak, Harry Potter'ı izleyerek, Fight Club'ı izleyerek falan bir sürü film izledim, bir sürü kitap okudum. Hepsinde sevdiğim kitaplar, sevdiğim filmler oldu. Çoğu, büyük çoğunluğu. Hani olabildiğince sevdiğim işleri yaparaktan aslında gün sonunda güzel diyebileceğimiz bir şekilde bitirdim hani. Bu iş böyle oluyor zaten. Öbür türlü ben neler neler duydum. İnsanlar böyle 30-40 kilo alıyorlar stresten. İnsanlar okulu bırakıyorlar. İnsanlar hap atıyorlar derken ilaç kullanmaya başlamak zorunda kalıyorlar böyle sinirden, stresten, kafaları ağrıyor, cırtçır falan. Değiyor yani anlatabiliyor muyum? Şu kanal 250, şu an 264 o falan oldu herhalde. Video oldu. Hani en ufak karım yok biliyorsunuz. Hani 50 abone var. Biri bile videoları baştan sona izlemiyor falan. Değiyor. Yani çünkü insanların ne büyük sıkıntılar çektiğini biliyorum. Kendimle çektim onu biliyorum. Kendi çektiğimden çok tanıdığım bir iki isim var. Bu isimlerin 3-4-5 seneleri oldu hazırlığı hala geçmeyeli ama okula da hala bir umut devam etme şeyleri olduğu için işe güce yeni okulları da başlamadıkları falan çok büyük acılar var ve bu insanlara yardım eden şeyler ya ciddi para karşılığında oluyor ki ciddi para karşılığında olan yöntemlerin bile böyle zevkli ne bileyim verimli geçtiğini düşünmüyorum. Yine ezbere kaçıyorlar falan bir yere kadar. Şu kanal tarzı bir şey lazımdı. Ben onu koyuyorum burada. Benim de karı hani bu işi başlamamdaki kar, benim edindiğim kar sizin edineceğiniz kardan daha fazla oluyor. Yani böyle direkt konuşma olayında iyi olmayan bir insan olarak resmen 250 videodan 125'in üstüne saatlik materyal cayır cayır konuşuyorum falan. Yani o din konusu falan insanlarla onları böyle oturup onun üstüne geliştirecek kadar konuşacak bir insan bulamadığım için şu kanal bahanesiyle onların üstüne bayağı uzun uzun konuşabildiğim oldu. Hatta bir second side'e getireceğimiz kadar bir part 2'yi başlatabileceğimiz kadar iş gelişti falan. Very good diyoruz. Sonra bunlar direkt şeydi zaten. Ben bu kitapları kendi başıma kalıyor olsaydım bu kitapları okuyacaktım zaten. Ne oldu? Hani o işi resmen başka insanların faydalanabileceği bir şeye çevirdi falan. Yani kendi boş zamanda yapacağım iş böyle depolanabilen bir hale getirildi falan. Very good yine falan. Şimdi aklıma yine düşünsem bir iki bir şey daha gelir ama bu verdiğim üç sebep yine gayet geçerli zaten. Bu iş aşırı iyi bir iş. Hem benim açımdan hem de sizin açınızdan. Tek şeyi, tek dezavantajı bana para getirmediği için falan ne oluyor? Eninde sonunda bu işe verdiğim emeği azaltıp hayatta kalmak için vereceğim emeği kaydırmam gerekecek falan. Bu durumda aşırı yavaşlayacak bu kanala video yükleme olayı şu anki hızıma kıyasla. Hayat sürprizlerle dolu. Belki bir şekilde bir para mara kazanırım bu işten de hayatımın sonuna kadar ya da en azından kendi yapmak istediğim zamana kadar yapmaya devam edebilirim falan. Onun dışında iyi gidiyor o zaman şu an. Ya daha bir ayımız var. Şu bir ayda yine var gücümle, var hızımla devam edeceğim. Ortaya bir şeyler koyalım, kafi yani. Bana düşeni yapmış olacağım. En azından şu yaz çıktığı zaman tamam bu yaz bana düşeni yaptım. Elimden gelen en büyük hızla da video çekmeye, yüklemeye devam ettim falan diyebileyim. Onun o vicdan azabı olmasın okul başladığı zaman falan. Ama gönül isterdi ki şu Harry Potter'lar bitmeden şu okula başlamayayım. Hani o bölünmesin falan. Ölüm yağdığı yerlere bölünecek yani. Neyse ama hiç yoktan eninde sonunda çekebileceğimi biliyorum ara tatilde falan. Bir aksilik çıkmazsa hani yarım yamalak kalmayacak. Yani hele oraya kadar gelmişim. Ama Harry Potter'ları bitirmeden hani kanalı bırakmayı düşünüyorsam bile olmaz. Önce Harry Potter'lar biter yani. Ama şu an kanalı bırakmayı düşünmüyorum. Bırakmak da istemiyorum da. Yani inanılmaz şeyler çıkarıyoruz çünkü. Materyal çıkarıyoruz ortaya. Ve biliyorum o hazırlığı geçemeyen insanlar neler yaşıyor falan. Benim boynumun borcu oldu artık. Benden başka kimse yapmıyor. Geçen bir kanal buldum dediydim bunu. 8 video yükleyip bırakmış falan. Öyle insanların size video yüklemesi için onları beklemeye kalmanız falan üzücü yani. Birisi en azından 400-500 sayfalık bir şey oluşturacak ki benim kafamdaki 3000-4000 videoluk bir şeydi. Belki olur birkaç sene sonra. Neyse en azından şu an bile çok şey var yani. 300 video olsa 150 saat. Böyle 150 saatin 150 saatini izlemiş olsanız bence bayağı bir hani hiç olmadı kendi yolunuzu çizecek bir fikre edinmiş olursunuz. O bile bir şey yani. Ama ben şey diyorum direkt böyle o kadar çok video olsun ki videolar bitmeden siz işinizi halledebilmiş olun. Sınav işte proficiency, geçebilmiş olun falan. Böyle zevkine falan dinlemeye devam edin falan gibi olsun. Ben bunu istiyorum asıl. Ya da böyle şey olsun. Hani o kadar çok kitap okumuş olsun ki bu kanalda. Siz böyle kitabı seçin. İşte ben Game of Thrones okuyacağım, Yüzüklerin Efendisi okuyacağım, Harry Potter okumak istemiyorum, Harry Potter'ı sevmiyorum falan. Olun böyle seçimler yapabildim falan. O da güzel. Öyle bütün bunlar aynı zamanda ben ne bileyim iş çerçürt görüşmesi falan olursa onlarda da kullanabileyim. Bunlar benim artma olsun falan. Burs murs artık. Gerçi burs şeyi de bitiyor. Okul bitiyor çünkü. Ben yüksek lisans doktora falan devam etmeyi düşünmüyorum açıkçası üniversitede. I am done with university yani. Zaten sevmiyorum. Bana bir şey katmıyorlar. Ne gerek var diyorum hayatın içinden. Şöyle yine kendimi aşırı kısıtlanmış hissetmeyeceğim bir iş bulurum diyorum. Hayatta kalırım onunla beraber. Boş zamanlarda da devam ederiz böyle. Gayri yaşlanma ölene kadar da giderim böyle yani. Güzel çünkü sarıyor. Geçen video kaç saat sürdü lan? 4 saat 5 dakika sürdü bak. Şaka falan değil yani. Oluyor mu oluyor? Konuşuyoruz işte, sarıyor falan. O videoda bir yer var, resmen böyle hipnoz oldum dedim size. O sağdaki insanlar böyle ne bileyim piyano miyano çalarken bazen böyle bir yere gidiyorlar falan. Oraya gittim dedim falan. Gittim cidden. Ve gerçekten o derece daldığımı hatırladığım, o derece şey olduğum, dikkatimin tek bir yere toplandığı falan, hay olduğum zamanlar dışında bir zaman hatırlamıyorum yakın gelecekte. O bana böyle iyice şey etti yani. Tamam dedim. Senin olayın bu Abdullah dedim. Sen bu işi iyi yapıyorsun. Bu işten faydalanabilecek insanlar da var. Sen bu işe devam et dedim yani. Artı zaten kendi kendime yaptım işti falan. Konuştuk zaten daha demin. Her türlü iyi yani. İnsan konuşuyor konuşuyor 5 dakika 10 dakika sonra birden susuyor. Çünkü lafı bitiyor falan. İlginç bir olay. Bitti herhalde. Şuradayız. Diyecek son bir şey var mı? Şöyle bir durayım. No, devam. It's a pause for his happy. He sees as strong. Propping a chocolate frog card featuring Dumbledore against his water jug. Not at all, said Ginny. He's really, really miserable, actually. She lowered her voice to a whisper. He keeps saying Umbridge was the best thing that ever happened to Hogwarts. All six of them looked around. Professor Umbridge was lying in a bed opposite them, gazing up at the ceiling. Dumbledore had strode alone into the forest to rescue her from the centaurs. How he had done it, how he had emerged from the trees, supporting Professor Umbridge without so much as a scratch on him, nobody knew, and Umbridge was certainly not telling. Since she had returned to the castle, she had not, as far as any of them knew, uttered a single word. Ve bayağı travma bir şey olmuş. İyi ki de olmuş diyoruz, of course. Nobody really knew what was wrong with her either. Her usually neat mousy hair was very untidy and there were bits of twig and leaf in it. But otherwise, she seemed to be quite unscathed. Madame Pomfrey says she's just in shock, whispered Hermione. Sulking, more like, said Ginny. Yeah, she shows signs of life if you do this, said Ron. And with his tongue he made soft clip clopping noises. Böyle at şey sesi yapmış. Toynak sesi falan. Falan herhalde. I said a bolt of pride, looking wildly around. Anything wrong, Professor called Madame Pomfrey, poking her head around her office door. No, no, said Umbridge, sinking back into her pillows. No, I must have been dreaming. Hermione and Ginny muffled their laughter in the bedclothes. Speaking of centaurs, said Hermione, when she had recovered a little, who's the divination teacher now? Is Franz staying? He's got two, said Harry. The other centaurs won't take him back, will they? It looks like he and Trelawney are both going to teach, said Ginny. But Dumbledore wishes he could have got rid of Trelawney for good, said Ron, now munching on his 14th frog. Mind you, the whole subject's useless if you ask me. Friends isn't a lot better. How can you say that, Hermione demanded, after you just found out that there are real prophecies? Harry's heart began to race. He had not told Ron, Hermione, or anyone else what the prophecy had contained. Neville had told them it had smashed while Harry was pulling him up the steps in the death room. And Harry had not yet corrected this impression. He was not ready to see their expressions when he told them that he must be either murderer or victim. There was no other way. It is a pity it broke, said Hermione, quietly shaking her head. Yeah, it is, said Ron. Still, at least you know who never found out what was in it either. Where are you going? He added, looking both surprised and disappointed as Harry stood up. Hagrid, said Harry, you know, he just got back and I promised I'd go down and see him and tell him how you two are. All right then, said Ron grumpily, looking out of the dormitory window at the patch of bright blue sky beyond. Wish we could come. Say hello to him for us, called Hermione as Harry proceeded down the ward and asked him what's happening about his little friend. Harry gave a wave of his hand to show he had heard and understood as he left the dormitory. The castle seemed very quiet even for a Sunday. Everybody was clearly out in the sunny grounds, enjoying the end of their exams and the prospect of a last few days of term unhampered by studying or homework. Harry walked slowly along the deserted corridor, peering out of windows as he went. He could see people messing around in the air over the Quidditch pitch and a couple of students swimming in the lake, accompanied by the giant squid. He was finding it hard at the moment to decide whether he wanted to be with people or not. Whenever he was in company, he wanted to get away, and whenever he was alone, he wanted company. He thought he might really go and visit Hagrid, though he had not talked to him properly since he had returned. Harry had just descended the last marble step into the entrance hall when Malfoy, Crabbe, and Goyle emerged from a door on the right that Harry knew led down to the Slytherin common room. Harry stopped dead so that Malfoy and the others. For a few moments, the only sounds were the shoots, louder, and splashes drifting into the hall from the grounds through the open front doors. Malfoy glanced around. Harry knew he was checking for signs of teachers. Then he looked back at Harry and said in a low voice, "You're dead, Potter." Harry raised his eyebrows. "Funny," he said. "You think I'd have stopped walking around?" Malfoy looked angrier than Harry had ever seen him. He felt a kind of detached satisfaction at the sight of his pale, pointed face contorted with rage. "You're going to pay," said Malfoy in a voice barely louder than a whisper. "I am going to make you pay for what you've done to my father." "Well, I'm terrified now," said Harry sarcastically. "I suppose Lord Voldemort's just a warm-up act compared to your tree. What's the matter?" he said. For Malfoy, Crabbe and Goyle had all looked stricken at the sound of the name. "He's your dad's mate, isn't he? Not scared of him, are you?" "You think you're such a big man," Potter said Malfoy, advancing now, Crabbe and Goyle flanking him. "You wait, I'll have you. You can't land my father in prison." "I thought I just had," said Harry. "The Dementors have left Azkaban," said Malfoy quietly. "Then the others will be out in no time." "Yeah, I expect they will," said Harry. "Still, at least everyone knows what's come back there now." Malfoy's hand flew over his wand, but Harry was too quick for him. He had drawn his own wand before Malfoy's fingers had even entered the pocket of his robes. "Potter!" The voice rang across the entrance hall. Snape had emerged from the staircase leading down to his office, and at the sight of him, Harry felt a great rush of hatred beyond anything he felt toward Malfoy. Whatever Dumbledore said, he would never forgive Snape, never. "What are you doing, Potter?" said Snape, coldly as ever, as he strode over to the four of them. "I'm trying to decide what curse to use on Malfoy," sir, said Harry fiercely. Snape stared at him. "Put that wand away at once," he said curtly. 10 points from grief, Daddy can. Snape looked toward the giant hourglasses on the walls and gave a sneering smile. "Ah, I see there are no longer any points left in the Gryffindor hourglass to take away. In that case, Potter, you will simply have to add some more." Professor McGonagall had just thumped up the stone steps into the castle. She was carrying a tartan carpet bag in one hand and leaning heavily on a walking stick. Buck, buck, buck, be silly snake. Stick with her other, but otherwise looked quite well. "Professor McGonagall," said Snape, striding forward. "Out of sight among us, I see." "Yes, Professor Snape," said Professor McGonagall, shrugging off her traveling cloak. "I'm quite as good as new. You too, Crabbe, Goyle." She beckoned them forward imperiously, and they came, shuffling their large feet and looking awkward. "Here," said Professor McGonagall, thrusting her carpet bag into Crabbe's chest and her cloak into Goyle's. "Take these up to my office for me." They turned and stomped away up the marble staircase. "Right then," said Professor McGonagall, looking up at the hourglasses on the wall. "Well, I think Potter and his friends ought to have 50 points apiece for alerting the world to the return of you know who. What say you, Professor Snape?" "What?" snapped Snape, though Harry knew he had heard perfectly well. Oh, well, I suppose. So there's 50 each for Potter, the two Weasleys, Longbottom, and Miss Granger, said Professor McGonagall, and a shower of rubies fell down into the bottom bulb of Gryffindor's hourglass as she spoke. Oh, and 50 for Miss Lovegood, Lovegood, I suppose, she added, and a number of sapphires fell into Ravenclaw's glass. Now you wanted to take 10 from Mr. Potter, I think, Professor Snape. So there we are. A few rubies retreated into the upper bulb, leaving a respectable amount below, nevertheless. Well, Potter, Malfoy, I think you ought to be outside on a glorious day like this, Professor McGonagall continued briskly. He did not need telling twice. He thrust his wand back inside his robes and headed straight for the front doors without another glance at Snape and Malfoy. The hot sun hit him with a blast as he walked across the lawns toward Hagrid's cabin. Students lying around on the grass, sunbathing, talking, reading the Sunday Prophet, and eating sweets looked up at him as he passed. Some called out to him or else waved, clearly eager to show that they, like the Prophet, had decided he was something of a hero. He said nothing to any of them. He had no idea how much they knew of what had happened 3 days ago. But he had so far avoided being questioned and preferred it that way. He thought at first when he knocked on Hagrid's cabin door that he was out, but then Fang came charging around the corner and almost bowled him over with the enthusiasm of his welcome. Hagrid, it transpired, was picking runner beans in his back garden. "All right, Harry," he said, beaming, when Harry approached the fence. "Come in, come in. We'll have a cup of dandelion juice." Siri değil mi lan o? "We'll have a cup of dandelion, dandelion juice," diyeceğim. "How's things?" Hagrid asked him as they settled down at his wooden table with a glass apiece of iced juice. "Yeah, feeling all right, are you?" Harry knew from the look of concern on Hagrid's face that he was not referring to Harry's physical well-being. "I'm fine," he said quickly, because he could not bear to discuss the thing that he knew was in Hagrid's mind. "So, where have you been?" "Been hiding out in the mountains," said Hagrid, "up in a cave like Sirius did when he..." Hagrid broke off, cleared his throat gruffly, looked at Harry, and took a long draught of juice. "Anyway, back now," he said feebly. You look better," said Harry, who was determined to keep the conversation moving away from Sirius. "What? What?" said Hagrid, raising a massive hand and feeling his face. Oh, yeah, well, Gropey's lords better behave now, lords. Well, Gropey's lords better behave now, lords. Dur, tamam şimdi doğru okuyacağım. Well, Gropey's lords better behave now, lords. Seemed right pleased to see me when I got back, to tell you the truth. He's a good lad, really. I've been thinking about trying to find him a lady friend, actually. He would normally have tried to persuade Hagrid out of this idea at once. The prospect of a second giant taking up residence in the forest, possibly even wilder and more brutal than Grove, was positively alarming. But somehow he could not muster the energy necessary to argue the point. Böyle Hagrid'e hayır demesi gerektiğini biliyor. Hagrid iyice yaralanacak, orman karışacak, Gertrude falan. Ama böyle bir yandan da o kadar yorgun ki bu 3 gün önce işte kitaba göre olan olaylardan, işte Sirius muhabbeti falan. Resmen böyle hiçbir şey demiyor falan. Ben de aynısını Bengisu en ufak değil onun bir üstü olan kardeşim de yaşıyorum. Bazen böyle hani o kadar şey ki böyle yoruyor ki beni böyle haksız olduğu halde hiçbir şey demiyorum falan. Bazen böyle dönüp gittiğim bile oluyor falan kavga ettiğimiz zaman falan. Çünkü devam edemiyorum böyle. Hani enerji yok yani bak bak bak var ya çok çok şey ya bir dakika. Biz öyle yani. Direkt biliyorum bu hissi. But somehow he could not master the energy necessary to argue the point. He was starting to wish he was alone again, and with the idea of hastening his departure, he took several large gulps of his dandelion juice, half emptying his glass. Dandelion diye okuyorum. Doğru da olabilir aslında. Yani böyle okunuyor gibi olabilir falan ama bence değil diyecektim. Ama olabilir. Bakmayacağım. Siz istiyorsanız bakın. Everyone knows you've been telling the truth now, very. Said Hagrid softly and unexpectedly. This gotta be better, hasn't it? Hasn't it? Aynen. Harry shrugged. Look, Hagrid leaned to toward him across the table. When you've seen us longer than you did, he died in battle, and that's the way he'd wanted to go. He didn't want to go at all, said Harry angrily. Hagrid bowed his great shaggy head. Nah, I don't reckon he did, he said quietly. But still, Harry, he was never one to sit around at home and let other people do the fighting. He couldn't have lived himself. He couldn't have lived with himself if he hadn't gone to help. He leapt up again. I've got to go and visit Ron and Hermione in the hospital wing, he said mechanically. Oh, said Hagrid, looking rather upset. Oh, all right then, Harry. Take care of yourself then and drop back in if you got a moment falan. Yeah, right. Harry crossed to the door as fast as he could and pulled it open. He was out in the sunshine again before Hagrid had finished saying goodbye and walked away across the lawn. Once again, people called out to him as he passed. He closed his eyes for a few moments, wishing they would all vanish, that he could open his eyes and find himself alone in the grounds. A few days ago, before his exams had finished and he had seen the vision Voldemort had planted in his mind, he would have given almost anything for the wizarding world to know that he had been telling the truth, for them to believe that Voldemort was back and know that he was neither a liar nor mad. Now, however, he walked a short way around the lake, sat down on its bank, sheltered from the gaze of passers-by behind a tangle of shrubs, and stared out over the gleaming water, thinking. Perhaps the reason he wanted to be alone was because he had felt isolated from everybody since his talk with Dumbledore. An invisible barrier separated him from the rest of the world. He had always been a marked man. It was just that he had never really understood what that meant. And yet sitting here on the edge of the lake, it was just that he had never really understood what that meant. Yani şimdi anlıyor. Cidden seçilmiş uşak bu. Ya bu ölecek ya Voldemort ölecek falan. And yet sitting here on the edge of the lake with the terrible weight of grief dragging at him with the loss of serious sorrow and fresh insight, he could not muster any great sense of fear. It was sunny and the grounds around him were full of laughing people, and even though he felt as distant from them as though he belonged to a different race, it was still very hard to believe, as he said here, that his life must include or end in murder. He said there, buna bu kadar takıldığını da hatırlamıyordum ha. Ve resmen öldürecek olmaya da ölecek olmaya çok takıyor şu an. Hani öldürmek istemiyorum falan yapıyor böyle. Ama doğru of course. Altıncı kitapta göreceğiz neden doğru olduğunu. Birini öldüresiye ruhum bölünüyor çünkü falan. Aynen, bu hiç dikkatimi çekmemişti şu ana kadar. Diyecek bir şey var mıdır? Devam. He sat there for a long time, gazing out at the water, trying not to think about his godfather or to remember that it was directly across from here on the opposite bank that Sirius had collapsed, trying to fend off 100 Dementors. The sun had fallen before he realized that he was cold. He got up and returned to the castle, wiping his face on his sleeve as he went. Ron and Hermione left the hospital wing completely cured 3 days before the end of term. Hermione showed signs of wanting to talk about Sirius, but Ron tended to make hushing noises every time she mentioned his name. It was not sure whether or not he wanted to talk about his godfather yet. His wishes varied with his mood. He knew one thing, though, unhappy as he felt at the moment, he would greatly miss Hogwarts in a few days' time when he was back at number four, private drive. Even though he now understood exactly why he had to return there every summer, he did not feel any better about it. He did not feel any better about it. Indeed, he had never dreaded his return more. Professor Umbridge left Hogwarts the day before the end of term. It seemed that she had crept out of the hospital wing during dinner time, evidently hoping to depart undetected. But unfortunately for her, she met Peeves on the way, who seized his last chance to do as Fred had instructed and chased her gleefully from the premises, waking her alternately with a walking stick and a sack full of chalk. Many students ran out into the entrance hall to watch her running away down the path, and the heads of houses tried only half-heartedly to restrain their pupils. Indeed, Professor McGonagall sank back into her chair at the staff table after a few feeble remonstrances and was clearly heard to express a regret that she could not run cheering after Umbridge herself because Peeves had borrowed her walking stick. The last evening at school arrived. Most people had finished packing and were already heading down to the end of term feast, but Harry had not even started. "Just do it tomorrow," said Ron, who was waiting by the door of their dormitory. "Come on, I'm starving. I won't be long. Look, you go ahead." But when the dormitory door closed behind Ron, Harry made no effort to speed up his packing. The very last thing he wanted to do was to attend the end-of-term feast. He was worried that Dumbledore would make some reference to him in his speech. He was sure to mention Voldemort's return. He had talked to them about it last year, after all. He pulled some crumpled drops out of the very bottom of his trunk to make way for folded ones and as he did so, noticed a badly wrapped package lying in a corner of it. He could not think what it was doing there. He bent down, pulled it out from underneath his trainers, and examined it. He realized what it was within seconds. Sirius had given it to him just inside the front door of 12 Grimmauld Place. "Use it if you need me, right?" He sank down onto his bed and unwrapped the package. Out fell a small square mirror. It looked old. It was certainly dirty. He held it up to his face and saw his own reflection looking back at him. He turned the mirror over. There on the reverse side was a scribbled note from Sirius. "This is a two-way mirror. I've got the other. If you need to speak to me, just say my name into it. You'll appear in my mirror and I'll be able to talk in yours. James and I used to use them when we were in separate detentions." Then Harry's heart began to race. He remembered seeing his dead parents in the mirror of Erised 4 years ago. He was going to be able to talk to Sirius again right now. He knew it. He looked around to make sure there was nobody else there. The dormitory was quite empty. He looked back at the mirror, raised it in front of his face with trembling hands, and said loudly and clearly, "Sirius." His breath misted the surface of the glass. He held the mirror even closer, excitement floating through him, but the eyes blinking back at him through the fog were definitely his own. He wiped the mirror clear again and said, so that every syllable rang clearly through the room, "Sirius Black." Nothing happened. The frustrated face looking back out of the mirror was still definitely his own. Sirius didn't have his mirror on him when he went through the archway, said a small voice in Harry's head. "That's why it's not working." He remained quite still for a moment, then hurled the mirror back into the trunk where it shattered. He had been convinced for a whole shining minute that he was going to see Sirius, talk to him again. Disappointment was burning in his throat. He got up and began throwing his things pell-mell into the trunk on top of the broken mirror. But then an idea struck him. A better idea than a mirror, a much bigger, more important idea. How had he never thought of it before? Why had he never asked? He was sprinting out of the dormitory and down the spiral staircase, hitting the wall as he ran and barely noticing. He hurtled across the empty common room, through the portrait hall and off along the corridor, ignoring the fat lady who called after him. The feast is about to start, you know, you're cutting it very fine. But Harry had no intention of going to the feast. How could it be that the place was full of ghosts whenever you didn't need one, yet now? How could it be that the place was full of ghosts whenever you didn't need one, yet now? Şuan kimse bulamıyor. He ran down staircases and along corridors and met nobody either alive or dead. They were all clearly in the great hall. Outside his charm's classroom, he came to a halt, panting and thinking disconsolately that he would have to wait until later, until after the end of the feast. But just as he had given up hope, he saw it. But just as he had given up hope, he saw it. A translucent somebody, translucent olabilir, snake olmaya çalışıyorum. Somebody drifting across the end of the corridor. Hey, hey, Nick, Nick! The ghost tucked its head back out of the wall, revealing the extravagantly plumed head and dangerously wobbling head of Sir Nicholas de Mimsy for Pinkton. Good evening, he said, withdrawing the rest of his body from the solid stone and smiling at Harry. I am not the only one who is late then, though he sighed in rather different senses, of course. Nick, can I ask you something? A most peculiar expression stole over nearly headless Nick's face as he inserted a finger in the stiff ruff at his neck and tucked it a little straighter, apparently to give himself thinking time. He desisted only when his partially severed neck seemed about to give way completely. And now, he said, Nick, looking discomforted, can't it wait until after the feast? No, Nick, please, said Harry, I really need to talk to you. No, Nick, please, said Harry, I really need to talk to you. Can we go in here? He opened the door of the nearest classroom and nearly had just Nick's side. Oh, very well, he said, looking resigned. I can't pretend I haven't been expecting it. Harry was holding the door open for him, but he drifted through the wall instead. Expecting what, Harry asked, as he closed the door. You to come and find me, said Nick, now gliding over to the window and looking out at the darkening grounds. It happens sometimes when somebody has suffered a loss. Well, said Harry, refusing to be deflected, you were right, I've come to find you. Nick said nothing. It's, said Harry, who was finding this more awkward than he had anticipated. It's just, you're dead, but you're still here, aren't you? Nick sighed and continued to gaze out at the grounds. That's right, isn't it? Harry urged him. You died, but I'm talking to you. You can walk around Hogwarts and everything, can't you? Yes, said nearly headless Nick quietly. I walk and talk, yes. So you came back, didn't you? Said Harry urgently. People can come back, right? As ghosts. They don't have to disappear completely. Well, he added impatiently when Nick continued to say nothing. Nearly headless Nick hesitated, then said, not everyone can come back as a ghost. What do you mean? Said Harry quickly. Only wizards. Oh, said Harry. And he almost laughed with relief. Well, that's okay then. The person I'm asking about is a wizard, so he can come back, right? Nick turned away from the window and looked mournfully at Harry. He won't come back. Who? Sirius Black said Nick. But you did, said Harry angrily. You came back. You're dead and you didn't disappear. Wizards can leave an imprint of themselves upon the earth to walk palely where their living cells once trod, said Nick miserably. But very few wizards choose that path. Why not, said Harry. Anyway, it doesn't matter. Sirius won't care if it's unusual. He'll come back. I know he will. And so strong was his belief that Harry actually turned his head to check the door. Sure, for a split second, that he was going to see Sirius. pearly white and transparent but beaming, walking through it towards them. Şu an bayağı üzücü olduğunu hissedebiliyor musunuz bilmiyorum ama yani bayağı üzücü. Böyle şey oldum. Benim de ben kaç yaşındaydım o ara? 2009 muydu? 10 yaşındayken falan işte halam vefat ettiydi falan. O ara hissettiğim bir his geldi böyle falan. Hani böyle cidden bir yakınımız öldüğü zaman o hissettiğimiz o üzgünlüğü falan hissettim. Falan. Böyle bayağı dip bir his falan. Neyse bana şu an o geldi mesela. Yani yazar bir şekilde o kadar iyi yazıyor ki buraya. Harry de yazar çok iyi yazdığı için Harry o kadar üzülüyor oluyor ki. Harry'in o kadar çok üzüldüğünü böyle takip edebiliyoruz ki falan. Bayağı üzücü ya. Bu kitabın bu son bölümü böyleydi. Yani şimdi hatırladım. Üzücü yani. Hani böyle and so strong was his belief falan. Hani böyle o kadar güçlü bir şekilde inanıyor ki böyle Sirius'un hayalet olarak kapıdan gireceğine falan. Hani böyle şey bu. Çok nadir kullanılan bir anlatım tarzı ve doğru. Hani böyle. Bir şekilde aşırı inanıyor falan. Hani böyle bir şekilde inanıyor olmasına umuyor derdik ama o kadar güçlü bir şekilde inanıyor ki falan. Hani böyle o şoku hissediyoruz. O Harry'nin o içindeki o çaresizliği görebiliyoruz falan. Ama Sirius gelmeyecek falan. O şeyi itip itip duruyor böyle falan. Tam anlatamadım. Düşün Abdullah. Hani so strong böyle was his belief. Düşün. Yani normal olmayacak kadar strong. Hani normalde insanların düşünceleri bu kadar güçlü olmuyor hayatta. Hani böyle yaşamın esnasında, hayatın ortalarında, bir yerlerde falan. Yani düpedüz böyle şey, hasar görmüş, anlatabiliyor muyum? İçinde bir yerleri hasar görmüş. Elinin Sirius'un ölümüyle falan. Böyle so strong beliefleri falan oluşuyor. Böyle Sirius söz konusu olduğu zaman falan. Böyle herhalde. Neyse aynı. Ne anlattım herhalde. Devam. And so strong was his belief that he actually turned his head to check the door, sure, for a split second that he was going to see Sirius, pearly white and transparent but beaming, walking through it toward him. He will not come back, repeated Nick quietly. He will have go on. What do you mean? Go on, said Harry quickly. Go on where? Listen, what happens when you die anyway? Where do you go? Why doesn't everyone come back? Why isn't this place full of ghosts? Why? I can't answer, said Nick. You're dead, aren't you? Said Harry exasperatedly. Who can answer better than you? I was afraid of death, said Nick. I chose to remain behind. I sometimes wonder whether I oughtn't to have. Well, that is neither here nor there. In fact, I am neither here nor there. He gave a small chuckle. I know nothing of the secrets of death, Harry. For I chose my feeble imitation of life instead. I believe learned wizards study the matter in the Department of Mysteries. Don't talk to me about that place, said Harry fiercely. I am sorry not to have been more help, said Nick gently. Well, to excuse me, the feast, you know. And he left the room, leaving Harry there alone, gazing blankly at the wall through which Nick had disappeared. Harry felt almost as though he had lost his godfather all over again in losing the hope that he might be able to see or speak to him once more. He walked slowly and miserably back up through the empty castle, wondering whether he would ever feel cheerful again. He had turned the corner toward the fat lady's corridor when he saw somebody up ahead fastening a note to a board on the wall. A second glance showed him that it was Luna. There were no good hiding places nearby. She was bound to have heard his footsteps, and in any case, Harry could hardly muster the energy to avoid anyone at the moment. Hello, said Luna vaguely, glancing around at him as she stepped back from the notice. How come you're not at the feast, Harry asked. Well, I lost most of my possessions, said Luna serenely. People take them and hide them, you know. But as it's the last night, I really do need them back, So I've been putting up signs. She gestured toward the notice board, upon which, sure enough, she had pinned a list of all her missing books and clothes, with a plea for their return. An odd feeling rose in Harry, an emotion quite different from the anger and grief that had filled him since Sirius's death. It was a few moments before he realized that he was feeling sorry for Luna. How can people hide your stuff, he asked her, frowning. Bir dakika. An odd feeling rose in Harry, an emotion quite different from the anger and grief that had filled him since Sirius's death. It was a few moments before he realized that he was feeling sorry for Luna. Yani böyle birden, hani günlerdir Sirius'un ölümüyle oluşan şokun içinde falan ilk defa oradan çıktı herhalde sanırım Luna için üzülerek. Sanırım bu. An emotion quite different from the anger and grief that had filled him since Sirius's death. Aynı. Yani günlerdir ilk defa birden böyle başka bir şey hissetti. O da Luna için üzgün olması. How can people hide your stuff? He asked her, frowning. Oh, well, she shrugged. I think they think I am a bit odd, you know. Some people call me loony, Lovegood, actually. He looked at her and the new feeling of pity intensified rather painfully. There's no reason for them to take your things, he said flatly. Do you want help finding them? Oh, no, she said, smiling at him. They'll come back. They always do in the end. It was just that I wanted to pack tonight. Anyway, why aren't you at the feast? He shrugged, just didn't feel like it. No, said Luna, observing him with those oddly misty, protuberant eyes. I don't suppose you do. That man the Death Eaters killed was your godfather, wasn't he? Ginny told me. He nodded curtly, but found that for some reason he did not mind Luna talking about Sirius. Ölümü görmüş bir Luna. Kendi annesinin ölümünü gördü falan. Bunu da hissediyor bence. Artı insanlar bir şekilde böyle kendi yakınları öldüğü zaman diğer insanların onlara böyle başın sağ olsun triplere falan girmesini sevmiyorlar bence. Yani Luna'nın öyle bir tribe girmeyecek kadar normal olmayan bir insan olduğunu görüp rahatsız olmuyor şu an bence. Aynen. Yani şimdi bu dediğimle Hagrid'e hakaret etmişim gibi oldu. Aslında Hagrid'e hakaret etmiyor. Burada bir şekilde sadece Luna'nın doğru bir insan olduğu. Diyeceğim Hagrid'in de babası falan ölü lan gerçi. Tamam. Burada şeyi değiştiriyoruz. Lafı değiştiriyoruz. Gerçekten ben bunu dediydim zaten. Yani Luna normal sayacağımız bir insan olmadığı için kendi yakın arkadaşının sevdiği bir insan öldüğü zaman başın sağ olsun falan. Hani bu ses tonunu falan kullanmıyor falan. Hani insanlar bunu yapıyor. Biz onları sevsek, sevmesek, çok tanıyor olsak, az tanıyor olsak falan. Çoğunluğumuzda böyle bir tarz var falan. Luna'nın böyle bir tarz uygulamaya kalkışmaması, ihtiyaç duymaması, uygulamıyor oluşu falan Harry'e böyle iyi geliyor. Bence bu. İyi dedim değil mi ben? Bir şüphe var içimde ama iyi dedim yani. Harry nodded curtly, but found that for some reason he did not mind Luna talking about Sirius. He had just remembered that she too could see test rules. Şimdi Hagrid de görüyor ama düşün. Dediğim gibi hani Luna'nın o tribe girmeyişi Hagrid'i bile Sirius hakkında konuşmak istemiyorum tarafına çekerken Luna'yı çekmiyor. Bence böyle. Have you he began? I mean who? Has anyone you've known ever died? Ha, daha konuşmamış bir olma. Filmdeki Luna Harry diyaloğunu hep böyle hatırlıyormuş. Ama şimdi şeyi fark ettim. Harry kitap boyunca Luna buna en baş geldi. Ben sana inanıyorum you know who hakkındaydı. Right falan yaptı Harry böyle. Teşekkür bile etmedi. Ondan sonra ne oldu? İşte ne oldu? İşte şeyde kızdı. Bunlar tam teselleri bilmeden önce Sirius'un yakalandığını düşündüğü zaman işte sen gelmeyeceksin falan. Böyle hani uyuz uyuz konuştu falan. Yani ilk defa düzgün şu an konuşuyor. Bu Harry'e bazen çok kızıyorum yani. Çok fazla ödük çünkü. Have you, he began, I mean, who, has anyone you, no one ever died? Yes, Eluna, simply my mother. She was a quite extraordinary witch, you know, but she did like to experiment, and one of her spells went rather badly wrong one day. I was 9. I'm sorry, he mumbled. Yes, it was rather horrible, said Luna, conversationally. I still feel very sad about it sometimes, but I've still got that. And anyway, it's not as though I've never seen mama again, is it? Tam sanki filmde tıpatıp aynı bu oluyor da. Bu diyaloğun tıpatıp aynısını filmde kullanmışlardı gibi hatırlıyorum. Emin değilim. Devam. Isn't it, said Hiram, certainly. She shook her head in disbelief. Oh, come on. You heard them just behind the wheel, didn't you? You mean in that room with the Ark ve they were just lurking out of sight. That's all. You heard them. They looked at each other. Luna was smiling slightly. They did not know what to say or to think. Luna believed so many extraordinary things that he had been sure he had heard voices behind the veil too. Artı tesirleri görüyor Luna. Are you sure you don't want me to help you look for your stuff? He said. Oh no, said Luna. No, I think I'll just go down and have some pudding and wait for it all to turn up. It always does in the end. Well, have a nice holiday, Harry. Yeah, you too. She walked away from him, and as he watched her go, he found that the terrible weight in his stomach seemed to have lessened slightly. The journey home on the Hogwarts Express next day was eventful in several ways. Firstly, Malfoy, Crabbe, and Goyle, who had clearly been waiting a week for the opportunity to strike without teacher witnesses, attempted to ambush Harry halfway down the train as he made his way back from the toilet. The attack might have succeeded had it not been for the fact that they unwittingly chose to stage the attack right outside a compartment full of DA members who saw what was happening through the glass and rose as one to rush to Harry's aid. By the time Ernie McMillan and I bought Susan Bones, Justin Finch-Fletchley, Anthony Goldstein, and Terry Booth had finished using a wide variety of the hexes and jinxes Harry had taught them, Malfoy, Crabbe, and Goyle resembled nothing so much as three gigantic slugs squeezed into Hogwarts uniforms as Harry, Ernie, and Justin hoisted them into the luggage rack and left them there to ooze. I must say, I'm looking forward to seeing Malfoy's mother's face when he gets off the train, said Ernie with some satisfaction as he watched Malfoy squirm above him. As he watched Malfoy squirm above him. Above whom? Bunu anlamadım. Ernie had never quite got over the indignity of Malfoy docking points from Hufflepuff during his brief spell as a member of the Inquisitorial Squad. Goyle's mom will be really pleased, though, said Ron, to have come to investigate the source of the commotion. He's lost better looking now. Anyway, Harry, the food trolley is just stopped if you want anything. Harry thanked the others and accompanied Ron back to their compartment, where he bought a large pile of cauldron cakes and pumpkin pasties. Hermione was reading the Daily Prophet again. Ginny was doing a quiz in the Quibbler, and Neville was stroking his Luna York. Aynen. And Neville was stroking his Mimbulus Mimultonia, which had grown a great deal over the year and now made odd crooning noises when touched. Aynen. Harry and Ron whiled away most of the journey playing wizard chess while Hermione read out snippets from the Prophet. It was now full of articles about how to repel the Mentors, attempts by the Ministry to track down Death Eaters, and hysterical letters claiming that the writer had seen Lord Voldemort walking past their house that very morning. It hasn't really started yet, sighed Hermione gloomily, folding up the newspaper again, but it won't be long now. Hey, Harry, said Ron, nodding toward the glass window onto the corridor. Harry looked around. Cho was passing, accompanied by Marietta Edgecombe, who was wearing a balaclava. His and Cho's eyes met for a moment. Cho blushed and kept walking. He looked back down at the chessboard just in time to see one of his pawns chased off its square by Ron's knight. "What's going on with you and her anyway?" Ron asked quietly. "Nothing," said Harry truthfully. "I heard she's going out with someone else now," said Hamilton tentatively. Harry was surprised to find that this information did not hurt at all. Wanting to impress Cho seemed to belong to a past that was no longer quite connected with him. So much of what he had wanted before seriously that felt that way. Felt that way these days. So much of what he had wanted before Sirius's death felt that way these days. Çok değişmiş. Yani eskiden istediği, Sirius'un ölümünden önce istediği şeyin çoğunu istemediğini fark ediyor şu günlerde. The week that had elapsed since he had last seen Sirius seemed to have lasted much, much longer. It stretched across two universes, the one with Sirius in it and the one without. "You're well out of it, mate," said Ron forcefully. "I mean, she's quite good looking and all that, but you want someone a bit more cheerful. She's probably cheerful enough with someone else," said Harry, shrugging. "Who's she with now anyway?" Ron asked Hermione, but it was Ginny who answered. "Michael Corner," she said. "Michael," but said Ron, craning around in his seat to stare at her. "But you were going out with him." "Not anymore," said Ginny resolutely. "He didn't like Gryffindor beating Ravenclaw at Quidditch and got really sulky, so I ditched him and he ran off to comfort Cho instead." Burada çok basit bir olay da var bence. Ginny'ninkine Cho gidiyorsa, Cho'nunkine de Ginny gider falan gibi yani. Bak bak bak. She scratched her nose absently with end of her quill. Şöyle turned the quibbler upside down and began marking her answers. Ron looked highly delighted. "Well, I always thought he was a bit of an idiot," he said, prodding his queen forward toward Harry's quivering castle. "Good for you. Just choose someone better next time." He cast an oddly furtive look as he said it. Neyle bir bakışmış o. Neyle bir bakış o? Furtive. "Just choose someone better next time." He cast an oddly furtive look as he said it. Nasıl, bir dakika lan. Şöyle bakıyor, indiriyor gibi mi? Hani bir şekilde Hermione değil ama falan mı yapıyor acaba? "Bir dakika, well, I always thought he was a bit of an idiot," he said, prodding his queen forward toward Harry's quivering castle. "Good for you. Just choose someone better next time." He cast an oddly furtive look as he said it. Ha tam Ginny ile konuşuyor. Harry'e şöyle bir bakış atıyor falan. Sonra şey diyor. Harry'i seç falan gibi bir şey yapıyor yani şu an herhalde. Öyle mi oluyor lan? Eğer öyle oluyorsa Ron cidden çok şey ya, tripli bir insan yani. Sinirlenecek falan da çünkü. Hani bu kıskançlık şeyleri var ya böyle. Kram'la Hermione'yi kıskanmasındaki o böyle şey falan. Kram'a hayran, birden Hermione'ye düşmanla işbirliği yapıyorsun falan yaptıydı hani. Hani böyle şu an düpedüz kendi diyor ama. Hani eriyi seç gibi falan. Ama sonra böyle şey olacak. Ne olacak? Düşün Abdullah. Ha böyle işte uyuz uyuz davranacak yine falan. Tripli bu uşak yani baya. "He cast Harry an oddly furtive look as he said it." Aynen, diyeceğimi dedim. Diyecek başka bir şey var mı burada? "Nope." "Well, I've chosen Dean Thomas. Would you say he's better?" asked Ginny vaguely. "What?" shouted Ron, upending the chessboard. Crosshanks went plunging after the pieces and Hedwig and Pigwidgeon twittered and hooted angrily from overhead. As the train slowed down in the approach to King's Cross, Harry thought he had never wanted to leave it less. He even wondered fleetingly what would happen if he simply refused to get off, but remained stubbornly sitting there until the 1st of September, when it would take him back to Hogwarts. When it finally puffed to a standstill, however, he lifted down Hedwig's cage and prepared to drag his trunk from the train as usual. When the ticket inspector signaled to him, Ron and Hermione, that it was safe to walk through the magical barrier between platforms 9 and 10, however, he found a surprise awaiting him on the other side. A group of people standing there to greet him, whom he had not expected at all. There was Mad-Eye Moody, resimdeki kısım şu an bölümün başındaki, looking quite as sinister with his boulder head pulled low over his magical eye as he would have done without it, his gnarled hands clutching a long staff, his body wrapped in a voluminous traveling cloak. Tonks stood just behind him, her bright bubblegum pink hair gleaming in the sunlight, filtering through the dirty glass station ceiling, wearing heavily patched jeans and a bright purple t-shirt bearing the legend, the Weird Sisters. Next to Tonks was Lupin, his face pale, his hair graying, a long and threadbare overcoat covering a shabby jumper and trousers. Bir daha okuyacağım burayı. His face pale, his hair graying, a long and threadbare overcoat covering a shabby jumper and trousers. At the front of the group stood Mr. and Mrs. Weasley, dressed in their muggle best, and Fred and George, who were both wearing brand new jackets in some lurid green scaly material. Ron, Ginny called Mrs. Weasley, hurrying forward and hugging her children tightly. Oh, and Harry dear, how are you? Fine, lied Harry, as she pulled him into a tight embrace. Over her shoulder, he saw Ron goggling at the twins' new clothes. What are they supposed to be, he asked, pointing at the jackets. Finest dragon skin, little bro, said Fred, giving his zip a little tweak. Şöyle bir şey yapıyor herhalde. Business is booming and we thought we'd tread ourselves. Hello, Harry, said Lupin, as Mrs. Weasley let go of Harry and turned to greet Hermione. Hi, said Harry, I didn't expect. What are you all doing here? Well, said Lupin with a slight smile. We thought we might have a little chat with your aunt and uncle before letting them take you home. I don't know if that's a good idea, said Harry at once. Vernon işte yaz demişim, Vernon işte yaz demişim. I don't know if that's a good idea, said Harry at once. Hani böyle at once, at the final, Sirius'un olayları falan unutup bir anına Vernon eniştenin tekrar onunla buluşacağı düşünceleri falan aklına gelince bu iyi bir fikir değil falan, hemen böyle o moda girebildi falan. Hani şuradaki şu at once komik, tamam mı? Ben deyince komik olmadı as always ama komik. Oh, I think it is, growled Moody, who had a limp a little closer. That'll be them, will it, Potter? He pointed with his thumb over his shoulder. His magical eye was evidently peering through the back of his head and his bowler head. He leaned an inch or so to the left to see where Mad-Eye was pointing, and there, sure enough, were the three Dursleys, who looked positively appalled to see Harry's reception committee. Ah, Harry, said Mr. Weasley, turning from Hermione's parents, whom he had been greeting enthusiastically, and who were taking it in turns to hug Hermione. Well, shall we do it then? Yeah, I reckon so, Arthur, said Moody. Yeah, Mr. Weasley took the lead across the station toward the place where the Dursley stood, the perennial rooted to the floor. Hermione disengaged herself gently from her mother to join the group. Good afternoon, said Mr. Weasley pleasantly to Uncle Vernon, coming to a halt. Committing niye dedim acaba? Şu coming, şuradaki şu to'yu görünce bir anla böyle committing gibi oldu. Böyle oldu. Good afternoon, said Mr. Weasley pleasantly to Uncle Vernon, coming to a halt right in front of him. You might remember me, my name's Arthur Weasley. As Mr. Weasley had single-handedly demolished most of the Dursleys' living room 2 years previously, he would have been very surprised if Uncle Vernon had forgotten him. Sure enough, Uncle Vernon turned a deeper shade of puce and glared at Mr. Weasley, but chose not to say anything, partly Perhaps because the Dursleys were outnumbered 2-1. Aunt Petunia looked both frightened and embarrassed. She kept glancing around as though terrified somebody she knew would see her in such company. Dudley, meanwhile, seemed to be trying to look small and insignificant, a feat at which he was failing extravagantly. "We thought we'd just have a few words with you about it," said Mr. Weasley, still smiling. "Yeah," growled Moody, "about how he's treated when he's at your place." Uncle Vernon's moustache seemed to bristle with indignation, possibly because the boulder had gave him the entirely mistaken impression that he was dealing with a kindred spirit. He addressed himself to Moody. "I'm not aware that it is any of your business what goes on in my house. I expect what you're not aware of would fill several books," Dursley growled Moody. "Anyway, that's not the point," interjected Tongs, whose pink hair seemed to offend Aunt Petunia more than all the rest put together, for she closed her eyes rather than look at her. "The point is, if you find out you've been horrible to Hitty, and make no mistake, we'll hear about it," added Lupin pleasantly. "Yes," said Mr. Weasley. "Even if you won't let Hitty use the fairy tone, telephone, whispered Hermione. Yeah, if we get any hint that Potter's being mistreated in any way, you'll have us to answer to," said Moody. Uncle Vernon swelled ominously. His sense of outrage seemed to outweigh even his fear of this bunch of old balls. "Are you threatening me, sir?" he said, so loudly that passers-by actually turned to stare. "Yes, I am," said Medai, who seemed rather pleased that Uncle Vernon had grasped this fact so quickly. "And do I look like the kind of man who can be intimidated?" barked Uncle Vernon. Bu kelimeyi özellikle kullanıyor, böyle Uncle Vernon gibi insanlar, çünkü hani erkek adam dediğim bastırılmaz falan ya, böyle hani intimidated de bastırılmış falan gibi anlamı olması lazım, bakmayacağım. Öyle hani komik yani burası. "And do I look like the kind of man? Do I look like the kind of man?" Hani öyle bir adam gibi miyim? "Who can be intimidated?" Bir de bu kelimeyi kullanması falan komik. Uncle Vernon komikliği bunlar. "Well," said Moody, pushing back his bowler hat to reveal his sinisterly revolving magical eye. Uncle Vernon leapt backward in horror and collided painfully with a luggage trolley. "Yes, I'd have to say you do, Dursley." He turned from Uncle Vernon to Harry. "So, Potter, give us a shoot, if you need us. If we don't hear from you for 3 days in a row, we'll send someone along." Aunt Petunia whimpered piteously. It could not have been plainer that she was thinking of what the neighbors would say if they caught sight of these people marching up the garden path. "By then," Potter said Moody, grasping Harry's shoulder for a moment with a gnarled hand. "Take care," Harry said, looking quietly. "Keep in touch." "Harry, will have you away from there as soon as we can," Mrs. Weasley whispered, hugging him again. "We'll see you soon," May said Ron anxiously, shaking Harry's hand. "Sarılmıyorlar." "Really soon," Harry said Hermione earnestly. "We promise." Harry nodded. He somehow could not find words to tell them what it meant to him to see them all ranked there on his side. Instead, he smiled, raised a hand in farewell, turned around, and led the way out of the station toward the sunlit street, with Uncle Vernon, Aunt Petunia, and Dudley hurrying along in his wake. The end. Then, 5. kitabın endi. Şaka gibi ya. Böyle bir şey okuduk işte. İngilizce ya. Siz hazırlığı geçemiyordunuz. Şimdi 1108 sayfalık İngilizce kitabı bitirdiniz. Üstüne üstlük sadece kitabı değil, benim bütün yorumlarımı da dinlediniz falan. Çok iyi oğlum. Çok iyi. Ama biraz fazla tepki verdim onun için. Şey oldum. Bir garip oldum. Hala da kamera açık olan. Neyse. Son bir diyeceğimiz var mıdır? Düşünelim. Altıncı kitaba dair falan sanki bir şeyler demem gerekiyormuş gibi hissediyorum. Altıncı kitaba dair bir şeyler dememiz gerekiyor mudur şu an? It seems not then. Hadi kendinize iyi bakın. Görüşürüz.